Today, let me start off by just asking you a question, a very serious question, but a question nonetheless, and something that gets us into our sermon material today. That question is just this: would you like to meet God?
Amen.
Now, I don't mean that in the way that you would maybe get from like some kind of a suspense drama with, you know, bad guys fighting each other, because, you know, if they said, do you want to meet God, it would generally be a threat. I don't mean it as a threat at all. I mean it just the opposite. I mean it as something that would be an incredible blessing. Think about it. Meeting God. That would be fantastic. I mean, there are so many questions about God in the human race, right? I mean, as we walk through life, there's just so much that we don't know or don't understand about God. There's so much that is supposition, so much that speculation. It would really be nice just to meet him and have all of that stuff settled, have all of those kinds of concerns just washed away in the reality of actually meeting God. I want to say today that that is possible. It's actually possible to meet God and to meet him in such a way that there's really no doubt. You can meet God in such a way where that is clear, that is very, in a matter of speaking, very visible. And so you can understand God in terms that are not subject to the, you know, to the whims and fancies of the human race, nor to the winds of doctrine that come by people of faith. You can meet God. You can actually sit down and have a long talk with him. Wouldn't that be fantastic? You ever picture yourself sitting down at a table drinking a cup of coffee with God? Is that kind of thing even something that a human being can think about? Well, sure it is. And while you're doing that, what happens? Well, you really get to know him. Mostly, I think when human beings think about God being near to them, it brings out a little fear. Because all of their ignorance of what God's actually like or what God's actually up to leads them to fear the unknown power. We fear unknown power, don't we? If something is strong and powerful, but we're not really very, very cognizant of it, not very aware of it, not very knowledgeable of it, it just breeds fear. It makes us nervous. We don't know what it might do or what that kind of power might result in. All that would more or less disappear if you were just sitting down having a nice cup of coffee and a pleasant conversation. Can we know God that way? I think that we can. Now, humans endeavor, it seems to me, with the assumption that God is too transcendent to be known. I mean, I think that's what a lot of philosophers through history have thought, that God is just too far removed and too different than we are. And because he has this transcendent nature, it's just so far above and beyond everything that we're familiar with, that it would be impossible to know God. Think about it this way. For God to be known by us, for God to enter into a kind of communication and relationship and fellowship with us, it would almost be like one of us trying to talk to an ant. Now, I don't mean the kind you're going to have Easter dinner with here after church. I mean the six-legged variety. Well, maybe there's not much difference. I don't know your family, but could you talk to an ant? I mean, how long would that conversation last? The horizon of what the ant is interested in and understands isn't very far, really. I would not think, anyhow. I've never talked to an ant. But nonetheless, I think that sometimes the idea of transcendence of God is kind of cast in that kind of light. That it's just so much that it's absolutely impossible for any of us to so much as put a dent in it or make a scratch upon it. But I want to say that our lesson for Easter today, now we are in a series of messages here on Sunday morning over this month of March. It's been the lessons of Easter. And we've learned various things that we can take away from the Easter story and the Easter celebration that I think are important and that help us really keep things in a good perspective concerning us and God. Today, our lesson is, I think, the most important one. Of all the five, this is, I think, the biggest one, because this lesson teaches us this: God is knowable. Amen. God is understandable. God is relatable. God is lovable. All of us can enter into all of these descriptors in our interaction with God. And in fact, I would say to you, that's actually God's intent and purpose. And for us not to enter into these things, we're actually, in that sense, we are breaking the will of God. It's not God's will for us to stay strangers with Him. It's not God's will for us to walk around and have God as an unknown quality or quantity in our lives. It is God's will and God's desire that each of us know Him and that we know Him with some intimacy. I'm going to read you a text this morning out of the book of John, which will serve as our scriptural text in dealing with the subject matter this morning. And in this particular section, I like it because it's dealing with those numbskulls we call disciples. And, you know, I call them numbskulls because they were so slow in understanding what was in front of them. All the time that Jesus walked in front of them and did what He did and said what He said, they were not getting it. I mean, even someone, as we've talked about before, like Peter, or John for that matter, who wrote this text that we're in today, who were with Him on the Mount of Transfiguration, it still didn't kind of get any traction with them. It still just went right by them. You would think that being on the Mount of Transfiguration and watching Jesus turn into His glory right before them, that would have been something that left a mark. And it did. I mean, they were flummoxed by it at first. But how quickly did it actually take hold of their thoughts concerning Jesus? I think by the time they were down at the foot of the mountain, they were on to other things already. I think sometimes that's the way we are as human beings. But today, I want to say this. If your desire is to know God, then listen to what Jesus says about how we can find a pathway to that. And hear that it's not something that is forgettable. It's not something that we need, you know, lose just in the passing of life, just from coming down from the mountain. It's something that we can carry with us and walk with it in a relationship that is near and dear and sweet and powerful and sustaining. John chapter 14, I'm going to start reading with verse number 7. This is the New International Version of the Bible, and this is what it says there. If you really know Me, you know My Father as well. From now on, you do know Him, and you have seen Him. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. Jesus answered, Don't you know Me, Philip, even after I've been among you such a long time? Anyone who has seen Me has seen the Father. How can you say, Show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and that the Father is in Me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on My own authority, rather, it is the Father living in Me who is doing His work. Believe Me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in Me, or at least believe on the evidence of the works themselves. And may God add His blessing to the reading of His Word. Now, in this particular place in the Scripture, Jesus is actually trying to prep the disciples for His death. They had been together for about 3 years at this point in time, and they had gotten, you know, quite close during that time. They were walking together, eating together, traveling together, ministering together. I mean, they were just together constantly over 3 years. Can you get to know someone pretty well in that space of time, living at that level of closeness? Well, sure you can. Those of you who are married, I don't know how long it took you to get over all the difficulties of your initial time that you were together with your husband or your wife, but it takes a little while. You know, for Wendy and I, now it's 40 some years ago that we were married. In fact, 42, which is a long time. Some of you are not even 42 years old. All of my kids that are here, for instance. But some of you are not even 42 years old, and that, you know, that's how long Wendy and I have been married, and I think, wow. But I got to tell you, that first year was a little rocky. It wasn't rocky in the sense that we thought, what did I do? How can I get out of it? It wasn't rocky in that way. But I tell you what, it was just rocky in the sense that, you know, two people who have very strong ideas about, you know, where things belong and how dinner ought to be cooked and, you know, who should clean this and who should clean that and all of those kinds of things, right? It takes a little while to work those things out. For Wendy and I, it took a year of shouting. Yeah, I'd shout at her, she'd shout at me. Someplace along the line in that year, we discovered that there's a whole lot that really isn't worth shouting about. And then we got along. But by the time we were together 3 years, I mean, a lot of the rough edges had already been sanded off. You know, we were kind of in step. We were coming into our, you know, into our vibe, if you will. And I, you know, I just think about 3 years with Jesus, living as constantly as they did together. I mean, that was even more than Wendy and I lived together. I mean, you know, when we were first married, there were still all the things that were going on. You had to go to work. You weren't together during work, right? By the time that 3 years rolled around, I was at Bible college. Wendy was with me, of course, there. You go to work, going to school. There's so much of the day that you're not together. And, of course, when you're sleeping, it's hard to have a conversation then. About the only thing I've ever discovered that I can do well while I'm sleeping is driving. So if you see a silver Honda coming your way on the highway, just get out of the way. I mean, I would really just appreciate that. I wouldn't be tempted to, you know, call fire down from heaven upon you or anything else like that. But, just, you know, just get out of the way. I might be sleep driving. hopefully not. Okay. But what I'm saying is just this, is that these guys were together for a very intense time together for 3 years. I mean, they spent a lot of time together, more so than even, generally speaking, in our lives when we think about a married couple spending time together. Could they have the opportunity, did they have the opportunity to come to know Jesus quite well? I would say, oh, beyond doubt, they did. And yet, they were shocked in some respects. They were blind in a very real respect to who Jesus really was. Now, he's trying to prep them at this time that I read to you from the text of John for his death and his resurrection and his ascension, but it was flying right over their heads. Despite that 3 years, it just wasn't clicking for them. And I think that's why Philip, you know, gave that retort, "Show us the Father, and that will be sufficient." Jesus is talking with them about who he is and his connection with God and how close God was to all of them as a result of that. Whoosh, 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 all of those things going right by them, despite everything else that they had experienced with him. And Philip gets bold and says, you know, just show us the Father. You know, he's talking about the Father, he's talking about God and how, you know, how not transcendent, but how immanent God was. And they weren't seeing it, they weren't getting it, they weren't understanding it. And so Jesus is taking this opportunity to really bring some clarity to them. Basically, his response to them was, what are you talking about? Can't you see me? Philip says, show us God. And Jesus' retort was, huh? Here I am. That was more or less the dynamic of what was going on in this conversation. They weren't getting it, and Jesus tried to clarify to them. He made an astonishing claim to them, quite astounding when you think about it, because they weren't getting it. He said this, the Father is in me, and I'm in the Father. Now, I think for many, many people, it's oftentimes as they read through this, that just goes right by without a whole lot of thought. But today, I want you just to pause for a second and think about this. Because Jesus is making an absolutely incredible claim here that really needs to be understood, really needs to be examined. He was making an essential claim. And when I say essential, I don't mean that he was making a necessary claim or an important claim. I mean that he was making a claim about his essence as a being. And what was the claim that he was making? He was making the claim that he and the Father shared the same essence. He and the Father shared the same essence. And you say, wait a second, I don't see that, Pastor. Well, look at it this way. When Jesus says, don't you know the Father is in me? We can understand that simply enough in terms of just a person, a human being, being anointed by God. You know, that would be so much like Moses and the prophets of old. The Spirit of God came upon them and they were able to speak God's word, to speak it faithfully, with fidelity, with reliability. They were able to speak his word without error. Why were they able to do that? Because the Spirit of God had come upon them and the Spirit of God was enabling them to speak. We could take this along those kinds of lines. By this time, even in the history of Israel, this is, you know, a well-established theology for that. But that's not the claim that he was making. He went a step further. Not only did he say the Father was in him, but then he said this, and this is where the claim becomes a claim of essence. He says, I am in the Father. Whoa. Now, what would the Father need Jesus for if he was just another person, right? What would the Father need Jesus to be in him for if all he was another human being? Well, the answer is he wouldn't. If Jesus was just a human being doing God's will and work, there would have never been that secondary part of the claim, the essential claim that we're talking about this morning. Jesus would have said, don't you know the Father's in me? Don't you know the Father's with me? Don't you know the Father's upon me? Any of those kinds of things would have worked just fine. That's not what he said. Don't you know that the Father is in me? In other words, in that respect, that there is a connection between him and God that's at least on par with anyone that had ever gone before, all of those prophets of old. But also understand this, that the very nature of Christ is in the Father. Now, you know, that's a claim that most of us, if we heard it coming from someone today that looked like one of us, we would consider crazy. Because that's a clear claim for a person saying, I'm God. That's what Jesus was saying in this instant. When he says the Father is in me and I'm in the Father, what he's making an equation is that the Father and him equal in essence. They share the same divinity. Are you seeing this? That is an incredible claim, but it's the claim that Jesus made. And having made a claim, you can see why maybe, you know, the disciples, who were for the most part pretty good Jewish fellows, right? I mean, they, you know, I make fun of them sometimes for being bumpkins. I'm not saying they were the most intelligent Jewish fellows, but at the same point in time, they were good Jewish fellows in the sense that they believed the writings of the Old Testament. They tried to live in a way that was wholesome. I mean, except for Matthew. They tried to, in other words, fulfill the conception of what it meant to live rightly from a Jewish perspective. They were good fellows that were familiar with synagogue life and familiar with the scriptures. And boy, you know, hearing all of this was just a little too much for them. I mean, they're sitting there looking at somebody that they had the highest respect for up to this time. They're looking at someone that they, you know, really had high hopes for up to this time. Now he crosses a threshold and he puts himself in God in the same way that God is in him, making himself equal to the essence of God. That's a little much, isn't it? I mean, if I made this claim from the pulpit, this would probably be my last day in ministry, wouldn't it? If I made that kind of claim, how many of you would get out your pitchforks? You don't have any tomatoes with you, but you do have some eggs, baby. You know, they might be coming my way. Why? Well, because that's an outrageous claim for a human being to make. Especially one subject to death. But that's the claim that he was making. Make no mistake about it. Jesus was overtly, directly claiming to be divine. Now, what was his backup? Because, you know, I think that there was probably some hard swallowing amongst the disciples at this point in time. He said, look at the works. Look at the works. I mean, they had been close up, very personally involved as a witness to all the things that Jesus had been doing for the past 3 years. What has Jesus been doing? Well, here are some of the things that Jesus did. He raised the dead on several occasions. He did not do this with CPR. He did not do this with medication. He did this by a word of command. Come back to life. And his word of command brought the dead back to life. That's pretty astonishing, isn't it? He healed disease. Now, here's the cool thing about that. He healed things that were congenital. Things that people were born with. I mean, sometimes we have some doctors in our midst, right? At least one. There are some things that sometimes you can accomplish with those kinds of things through surgery and other kinds of interventions. But, you know, by and large, you're fixing things the best you can. You're not reversing those things. You're not making them as if they never were. Jesus healed people with congenital defects. Wow. He healed people who had pathologies that are, you know, very normal to disease, like fever and that kind of thing. He healed people who had been injured physically. Sometimes it made them lame. Sometimes it would make them something else, some other kind of incapacity, disability in their body. He healed them. That's pretty cool. He transmuted elements. I can change water into wine. Just get a bottle of Mogan David, pour it into a glass that has water in it. You change water into wine, right? Well, that's how I would do it because I don't have any power and I'm not God. Just so, in case you were a little worried about that from where I was just a minute or so ago. That's not what Jesus did. He did the impossible. I mean, there's not a chemist or a physicist around who would not tell you this is impossible. You can't do this. You can't instantly change one elemental thing into something else. You can't do it. Jesus did it. These are the works that he did. He was able to tell people what they were thinking. Generally speaking, when we try to do that kind of thing, we're just taking wild guesses. Right? And a lot of times we're doing so in the midst of some kind of interaction that is either manipulative or argumentative. You know, we try to suggest that, I know what you're thinking. No, you don't. Not even close. Jesus knew what people were thinking. I mean, are you getting the feel for this list of things that Jesus did? Jesus said, hey, I'm divine. What? Look at the words. They demonstrate. They prove it. But we're here today, in this place at this time, not Sunday, but particularly Easter Sunday. We're here today celebrating, remembering something else, something that I think is the greatest work. I mean, obviously, all those incredible things done on a repeated basis in front of these 12 men, ultimately 11, was not enough to get this truth across to them. That when they looked at Jesus, they weren't looking at just a man, they were looking at something more than a man. All the things that they had heard from his mouth, all the things that they had seen him accomplish and do, it did not communicate the truth about his nature. But the last work that he did to accomplish that was the greatest work, and it's the one that actually accomplished the feat. And what was that work? He rose from the dead. Now, we've talked about him rising from the dead in so many ways through the years, and hopefully some of that stuff stays with you. There's nothing more important in all the history of mankind that has ever happened than that. There's no event that is more important, not only to us who believe, but there's no event that's more important just in the scheme of God's governance over all of creation. There's nothing more important that has ever happened than Jesus coming out of that tomb alive. Nothing. Why? Well, because in that particular work, we have the clearest demonstration of who he is and what he can do. I mean, there's a lot of people who try to diminish the claims of Christ and try to diminish the testimony concerning Jesus that the church bore from this very start. And let's understand something here. The claims for Jesus, when you look at the records of text and whatnot, did not develop over hundreds of years like some people try to say. You actually look at the cases, you actually look at the evidence, you actually look at the record. The church from the very beginning, I'm talking 33, 34, 35 AD, was very clear about something. They claimed to see Jesus risen from the dead, and they believed that. That was that testimony, that was their faith from the very start. Amen. Right. This is not something that evolved. This is something that was a testimonial from the very start. Why is that important? Well, it is important because we aren't there. No, that's the thing about time. You get to live in your own time. You can't live in somebody else's. You know, it'd been pretty cool to walk around and see somebody do this or somebody do that. You know, I don't know what kind of things you love in history. I kind of like a lot of history. So there's a lot of places and times in history that would have been cool to sit around and see what was going on. We can't do that, right? That's just not the way that works. We get to see and experience what's in our own time. If something is happening in another time, what are we dependent upon? The testimony of the people that were in that time. That's what we have. We have a testimony from Jesus' followers, from those that were closest to him, from those that were with him and saw him, and that testimony was that he rose from the dead on the third day after he was killed. What an incredible thing to testify. I mean, that would have been the easiest thing in the world. You have to understand this. This was not something mythological like you would have in various kinds of religions like that of Egypt with Osiris or that with other things with Ishtar and her son and all the other bits of mythology that have resurrection themes in them. This is not none of those things. This is just something happening in the midst of a very well-developed culture, a very modern culture. You know, we think of Rome being old and ancient. Have you ever studied Rome? Amen. And the culture of Rome and the history of Rome? Those guys were not ignorant podunks. They had great records, they had great governance, they had great systems for society and whatnot. Jesus did not, appear as Jesus Christ Superstar likes to say in Judas's wanderings about such things or wonderings about things. It says, if you've come today, there would have been mass communication. Well, let me tell you something. Coming in the time of the Roman Empire was not a bad time to come if you wanted to make a splash. Right. Anyhow, those disciples, very quickly, very, very early, by all historical records that are reliable that we can look at, understood. They were convinced they had seen Jesus come alive out of the grave. Now, I said that was his greatest work. What am I getting to by that? Let me read to you just a very small snippet of scripture here that I think speaks to this point and really kind of puts the exclamation point on the end of all of this. This is out of the book of Romans chapter 1. It says this, speaking about Jesus, who, Jesus that is, through the Spirit of holiness was appointed the Son of God in power by his resurrection from the dead. Now that word appointed, as is translated in the NIV, that is not a good translation of what's there in the Greek at all. The word that's used there in the original language is a word that means demonstrated. It's a word that means proven. And so what that is actually trying to get across from the original language is that through the Spirit of holiness, Jesus was demonstrated the Son of God in holiness or in power by his resurrection from the dead. So what is the Apostle Paul saying here in Romans chapter 1 that's so important for us today? He's saying just this, is that the greatest work that Jesus did was rising from the dead, because in rising from the dead, that work had a greater testimony even than all of those things that he was telling the disciples back in John chapter 14 to look at. That certainly should have been sufficient. No one did what Jesus did in his 3 years of ministry. It's just an astonishing testimony of absolute wonder the world has never seen the likes of. That's very clear. Should have been enough, right? But in case it wasn't, here's the greatest work. He came out of the grave alive, victor over death, victor over sin. And in that singular work, we have the exclamation point, if you will, at the end of the testimony concerning Christ. This is the thing that demonstrates who he is and what he's done. And here is who he is. He is God in the flesh. God come to save us. God who demonstrated that he has the juice and the power to turn the one enemy that all of us face that no one else could, no one else can. We're all facing death. And after that, judgment. Right? That's a scary prospect. No one likes talking about that kind of thing. Well, I do. No one likes hearing about that kind of thing. Again, I do. No one is comfortable with that kind of thing for the most part in polite society. But here's the thing. When Jesus came out of that grave, he demonstrated for everyone that he wasn't just another teacher. He wasn't just another rabbi. He wasn't just another dude running around Palestine. Not even Palestine, Israel, in the ancient times. He is not just another person, just like all the rest of us are people. He demonstrated that despite all appearances when he was looked at, right? When he was stabbed, when he was nailed to a cross, despite all appearances otherwise, this one who looked just like one of us and seemed like he was nothing but human was hiding the fact within his nature that he was so much more. He wasn't just a man. He was more than a man. He was the God-man. And more than that, he was God in the flesh. Amen. And the thing above all things that demonstrates that is him walking out of the grave.
That's it.
And so today I ask you, when we started this time together as I was talking to you, I ask you, would you like to meet God? You remember it that far? Have I said too many words to wash it away in the loss of memory? Would you like to meet God? If you'd like to meet God, you don't have to go any further than Jesus Christ. You know, when you read the gospel accounts of Jesus Christ, when you see the story of his life and his walk with his disciples, it's always cool, because what do you find when you do so? You find that Jesus seems to be so approachable. You find that Jesus seems to have a really good attitude toward people. You find that Jesus definitely demonstrated an incredible compassion and a care for people. You know, you find when you look at Jesus that here's somebody who I could trust as a big brother. here's someone I don't mind hanging out with. Here's somebody, if he had a kingdom, I'd want to be in that kingdom. Right? I mean, when you look at the accounts of Jesus, his approachability, his humanity, in a matter of speaking, I tell you, it's so winsome. And yet we walk around oftentimes thinking about God as being some kind of a scary prospect. He's lost in transcendence. We can't get a grasp on any of the details. And in the loss or the lack of that kind of information, what do we have? Fear. You know, I think more than anything else, that's just a trick of the devil. The Bible tells us the devil keeps people in bondage through the fear of punishment. But what you have in Christ is this picture of someone who is so cool. Someone who definitely is so appealing and approachable. That's the very picture of God. I mean, when you look at Jesus, when you see what he's like, when you see the way that he interacts with us, you're seeing God responding to and interacting with people. No mystery about it anymore. No need to be in the dark and shadows about it anymore. Jesus is a spotlight showing all of us the mysteries of God. And in showing us the mysteries of God, so many cease to be mysteries any longer. Do you want to know God? You have no further to go than Jesus Christ. This, I think, is the most important message of Easter, the most important lesson of Easter. All of us can find in Christ Jesus a clarity, an honest-to-goodness interaction and relationship. We can find a transformation even, because the Bible tells us that if we put our trust in Christ, if we believe in who he is and what he's done, he gives us the Holy Spirit, and so God comes into us. And suddenly we have a relationship. We have an interaction. We have something that we can never achieve just by effort, no matter how strongly we would make that effort or how wisely we would pursue it. Jesus, God in the flesh, showing us exactly who God is and what's in his heart. When you look at Jesus, you know these things. You know how God feels about you. You know what God wants for you. You know what God wants to do in you. You understand it with a degree of clarity you cannot get to by any other means. So the man Jesus, he took our sins, he took our guilt, he took it to the cross, and he died under it. And then on the third day, he rose victorious over it from the grave. And in doing so, he did two amazing things. Number one, he took care of that sin and death. It's wiped out. I mean, you can't have double jeopardy in that matter of speaking, right? All of your sin was paid for by Christ on the cross. Therefore, there's nothing left for you to pay. Nothing left for you to prove. It's all been done on the cross by Christ. Amen. But secondarily, and more importantly than that even, Jesus demonstrated his divinity. And in doing so, gives us the opportunity to answer that question, would I like to know God? With a resounding yes. Not only is it an expression of desire or aspiration, it becomes a declaration of experience and a word of testimony. Would you like to meet God? You don't have any further to go to look than the Lord Jesus himself. Have you accepted that invitation to do so? Jesus says, look at me and you see God. Have you accepted his invitation and looked?